Good morning. Happy May.
Happy day.
Not day, May.
Hey, happy May Day.
May Day. I don't even know what this holiday is. It's just a long weekend. I'll tell you. Deborah and I are headed off to Vancouver, like she said, directly following the service. We're going down, actually, to do a reunion for Reverend Marilyn Knipp in Vancouver. Her whole congregation has come together to have some form of a reunion this afternoon to celebrate their center that they have there and that exists even today. But Marilyn was their minister for a great many years. And Deborah and I, as a matter of fact, used to go to the Vancouver Center when Reverend Marilyn was there. It was always a fun place to hang out in. It was down in Granville Island, and I can remember we'd come up from Palm Desert and we would associate and find a church to go to in Vancouver when we were living in California, and we would inevitably find our way down to the Granville Island Center, and there what we would do is listen to her message and listen to her speak. So it's kind of exciting for us to go down there and participate in this reunion. We're not students of hers. However, we did spend time with her, and we know her well over the last 20 years associating with her. So I think it's going to be a fun time tonight. They asked me whether or not I was prepared to do a roast of her. And I said, no, I don't know her well enough. Although I'll warn you, there pretty much isn't anyone on this planet that I couldn't roast if I really put my mind to it. I quit doing that, though. I quit doing that. I used to, actually. I used to be a cranky guy. Okay, so maybe I still am. But I used to be even crankier than I am right now. I can remember that I was so proud of my ability to be able to just tear a person to pieces, tear them to shreds if they came in front of me and if they confronted me in some way. This was years and years and years ago. This was back 40 years ago, probably. For some reason, that nature seemed to be a natural way to go. Have you noticed that our society has changed somewhat in your lifetime? Have you noticed that certain things have skewed and new ideas and new things have transformed and changed? What I want to talk about today is I want to talk about community. Specifically, I want to talk about spiritual community, but I also want to talk about community as a whole. I want to bring forward that idea that the community serves a purpose that actually is very, very valuable, and that my experience and my contemplation is something that we've kind of drifted away from and lost in our society and in our world. You know, I'm sure that you're the same as I am. I was born a citizen. Remember that word? Does everybody remember it? Am I the only one who remembers being a citizen? But it was the dominant word when I was a child. It really was. It was the dominant word, and what it represented for me was it represented some form of right and some form of responsibility that went with that right. And what I found happened in the last 5 decades is that citizen has kind of dropped off the lexicon of our vocabulary. Have you kind of picked up on that? It's kind of just disappeared and slid sideways somewhere along the line. The new catchphrase and the new label for who we are is consumers. It's true. If you read things now, they talk in terms of consumers, not in terms of citizens. What they've done is they being us, because we've allowed it to happen, we have transformed our lexicon and our mindset from being a citizen to being a consumer. We've transformed how we view ourselves and how we look at ourselves in the world that's around us. And in that, what happened was we lost some things, I believe. We let go of some things. And my idea behind a community, specifically a conscious community like the one that you're in today, my idea behind a community is that it refires and reignites that potential and that possibility that we belong to something that has depth. That there is something that we belong to that has all these rights that are attached to it, and also all these responsibilities that come naturally through it and as it. Our society has kind of transformed to a place where withholding and withdrawing seems to be the natural state of being. I remember when I was in Palm Desert before religious science, BRS, and before I discovered the ministry, I can recall that what happened was I was living a quiet, withdrawn life. My life as a farmer really was within the confines of my own home and taking care of my own self and my family and not really being part of anything and being connected to something at some kind of depth. Now, I realize that I'm speaking to the choir here. I realize that what I'm doing is I'm talking to people that are very involved in the community, but I'm talking about this as being something that I view our society as the majority of it, as opposed to those of us who actually belong to something. And when I say belong to something, I mean belong to anything where you put some passion into it and where you receive and get back again some sense and some idea of the value and truth of who you are. I was thinking last night when Deborah was thinking about the other thing she was talking about thinking about. Awakening to our magnificence. I was actually thinking about this question: is when was it in my life that I stopped feeling like I was of value to the world around me? At what point in your life did you wake up and discover that you had to change or you had to transform and become something different in order to fit into the world around you? My natural instinct is to go back, well, it seems like it's always been that way, but that's not true. There was something that occurred or something that happened in each of our lives that helped build those stepping stones to where we realized or where we thought we realized the truth about ourselves, which wasn't true. And we lost that authentic core of who we are. This teaching believes that every human being and everything that exists is divine in its nature. That it wasn't put here by kismet or accident. That indeed what had happened was it was put here and it was placed here for a purpose to fit perfectly with everything else that's happening so that it works in some kind of beautiful divine synchronicity. And the end result out of that, if we actually stepped forward and were the truth of who we were, if we stepped forward and didn't in some way block ourselves from our belief that we're not enough and therefore inspire us to act outside of our own being, that what we would actually do is we would live in that Eden, that heaven on earth, right here and right now, right as I speak. That we come together with our gifts and with everything in such a perfect way that what happens is it moves and flows smoothly without any block or without any stop. And that person who stands next to you is exactly the right person to be there in your life to be able to aid you. And when we think of ourselves from the terms of having that be our right, as opposed to having be something that we're trying to achieve so that we can become a better consumer as opposed to a better citizen, then the end result out of that is that we transform, and I'll speak for myself, I seem to transform who I am into what is expected of me from society as opposed to living my life from the truth and the light of who I am, this little light of mine. And so what we do is we develop different ways to be able to get in touch. And when I was in California, Southern California, and discovered the center for the first time, what I discovered was that there were a whole pile of people that were there that seemed a little strange to me because they were actually living out their authenticity and their actualization at least on a Sunday morning or at a get-together or at a class or at something to do with the church. Because what it had developed and what my teacher had created was he had built a center where it was okay for someone to be who they are. It was accepting and it was open and it was receptive to the truth of who you are no matter what, no matter what circumstances, no matter how. It didn't base itself on some kind of judgment. It didn't base itself on a judgment of these people are good, these people are bad, these people are okay. It based it on the point of view that it came back to the principle and the tenet that if you're here, then you are perfect. You are the right person in the right place at the right time. And that's exactly what we do here. That's how we create our spiritual community, is we create a place where for a period of time you're allowed to show up, and once you get to the point and the place where you can trust it, let go and relax and allow yourself to actually be the authentic you. To practice being who you are. How's that sound? I mean, you know, really, when you stop and think about it, how often are you not who you think you are? Or how often, rather, I'll rephrase that. How often do you act out of things that aren't the truth about who you are? How often do you act out of fear? How often do you act out of some kind of dread? Or how often do you act out of some kind of lack in your life? So that when you're in the outside world, what you're doing is you're actually supporting an idea which doesn't support who you are. And what I found when I found the center, and you know, I'm going to be totally honest with you. I probably could have found it in any church or any spiritual community that I went to if they spoke my language and if I was willing to accept it. Because I didn't go into this thing just easily. I just didn't march in and say, Yahoo, this is it. This is perfect for me right off the bat. I came from a cynical, withdrawn background, as I pointed out in the very beginning of this talk. And that cynical, withdrawn background pointed out to me certain things that I had to age and grow through in order to become the person who I really was, as opposed to the person I was pretending and trying to be. To actually awaken to the possibility that someone could accept me just the way I am without me having to be what? Abrasive? Domineering, controlling, weak, quiet, invisible. All of these things are parts that we play in the world around us, whether we know it or not. And what I love about spiritual community is it allows us the possibility to be able to show up in some communities and to be representative of who we really are if we give ourselves the opportunity to do it. To be able to step forward and act from a place of authenticity within ourselves, as opposed to from a place of fear or a place of doubt. And you know, what I found and what I find is that our society has done this transformation in a large degree in our world around us. So when I mention citizen versus consumer, I'm really falling back onto a shift that's taken place in the last 50 years in our world around us. I can remember as a child being born, and it was my obligation and my responsibility to support my community. It wasn't that it was something that I was going to act outside of myself to do, but it was my obligation to pick up a piece of paper. It was my responsibility as a citizen to help clean up. It was a responsibility as a citizen to participate and give of myself in the community in some way, to be able to share and make the world a better place. Now, you know, how many people here have watched the movie Finding Nemo? Well, we've got one love it, okay. So, you know, do you remember, my favorite part is when they're chasing the little fish and the seagulls are there chasing it. And they're all screaming, me, 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 as they fight over this little tidbit in the world around us. I don't want to be negative, but don't you find sometimes that the outside world looks an awful lot like that? Don't you find that sometimes what happens is that there's this competitive nerve that goes through everything, where people are chasing after something, and it becomes so important to receive the something that anything else that stands in its way is wrong. Well, you know, I think that that's where we've kind of leaned in the last little bit. It's probably a pendulum swing of some kind, and I'm sure it's coming back to normal. But the reality is that's not what we were born to do. If you think you were born to work the job that you're doing, you are mistaken. The old saying, if you're working for money, you're not getting paid enough. Well, if you're working for anything outside of yourself, or if you're doing anything outside of yourself, then it's not supporting you or nurturing you to become the truth of who you are, that authentic God individualization that is who you are. Erin had a beautiful treatment, and in it she said that, you know, we are accepting of all people at all ways, and that's exactly the truth. And it's an exercise that we do in our society. And that exercise is that we realize that there's only one thing that's happening, and that we are connected to that one thing in all ways. And that without you, that one thing wouldn't work right. There'd be something missing. There'd be something lost. There'd be something that didn't work in synchronicity with it. That we come together as a spiritual community, and we look around, or I can look around at our congregation, and I can see that each and every person is perfectly matched, even sometimes those people who other people don't think are perfectly matched. Perhaps you have some of those in your life. But they are perfectly matched to allow us to be able to awaken to our own authentic being. Sometimes it stirs something in us that we don't want to have stirred. That thing that we managed to shove away, that thing that in my experience, in my life, I shoved away so effectively when I left my community of Kelowna, when I moved to Southern California, when I formed my own family, when I divorced myself from my other family to a large degree, and where I withdrew into my own little shell to create something. And there was something missing in that moment. There was something missing in that lifestyle. There was something missing in that period, in that era of my life. And what was missing was my connection with humanity and my connection with life. And what was missing wasn't outside of me, it was inside of me. There was something happening within me that wasn't satisfied, fulfilled, happy, or productive. And the reason it was there was because I wasn't exercising it. I wasn't supplying it. I wasn't sharing it. I wasn't putting it out into the world around me. Each one of us is called to something greater than we think it is. We really are. You know, no matter where we go in life, no matter who we think we are, no matter how we act, what we are is we are there for the perfect reason, just like the person next to you is there for the perfect reason. And it's moves me to think that what we need to do is we need to remind ourselves that. We need to remind ourselves that we are part of something greater. That we just aren't something that is a consumer or something that is there because it supports with money or something that is there because of what we do and how we do it. It is there because of the heart behind it, and that which is divine, that which is infinite, that which has created all has not made a mistake by drawing us together into community. It has not made a mistake on the spiritual community. It hasn't made a mistake in your nuclear family. And it hasn't made a mistake in our society or our nation. There is no error in it. Each one of us plays a part in the world to perfection if we're willing to play it. And what prevents us from playing it is our need and our thought that somehow or other we have to be someone else in order to fit into the world around us. Somehow or other, I can't be that person that I want to be. It wouldn't fit. And most of that comes from stuff that we've heard or we've picked up around the world that just isn't true, that we've picked up in our lives that has told us something different. I was thinking about Reverend Barbara. When Reverend Barbara, may I share for you? Well, I don't know what it is, go ahead. That's a license, okay. I remember when Reverend Barbara came here, she didn't sing. Well, I shouldn't say that. She sang, but not in public. Do you know that? She never, isn't that correct? She did not sing. But she came here and she determined, she set her mind that what she was going to do is she was going to become who she was born to be. So she listened to her heart. She listened to her intuitive knowing. And she started to step up. And there are many, many people in this center that are the same way, including me, where we kind of slowly put our foot into it and say, oh, that felt okay, that can work. And so we put it a little bit further and say, that's okay, that works even better. And then we put it a little bit further, and that's all right, that's even greater. And then pretty soon, you're running a music department and you're becoming world known for your voice. That's that example. Where else can you train to do that other than here? If you stop and think about it, the answer is everywhere. But where else would you feel the safest to be able to do it? Where do you feel that it's possible for you to be able to step into it? People oftentimes think Sunday services are spiritual, and they are, but then so is everything else. They perhaps think that what this Sunday service is it's a lesson in how to live your life, or as Dr. Deborah said, another tool for your toolkit. And that's true. That exists and that's there. But you know what spiritual community is really about? Spiritual community is getting back to that tribal force and that energy of knowing you belong no matter what. It's coming back to that place where you're willing to actually start being yourself because you know that you have a right to be there. And how you get to that place and that point is you live up to the responsibilities that come forward on it and you be true to yourself and true to your life. You know, what happens for us is that in the summertime, sometimes it seems like our congregational flow dips a little bit. In other words, the numbers go down. Or else we have this thing called conscious giving that we put out there, and this isn't a sales pitch, but what it's to ensure is if people are away, they still support the center. And what I want to talk about spiritual community is, I really want to say is, there is no spiritual community without you. You're the spiritual community. And that therefore the responsibility of belonging to something is to show up for it. The responsibility to do that is to be able to be true to your own commitment to your own self and your own being. And it's so easy in this world to find ourselves thinking that I'm too busy to do this, or I'm too busy making a living, or I've got to do that, or I've got to do the next thing. And that's all valuable. And I'm not in any way knocking it. And I'm not in any way demanding that anyone show up anywhere. It's not just the spiritual community, it's how you play your life out in everything. It's where you set your priorities and how you focus on them and set them as an intention in front of you, and whether or not you live to the commitment of growing into them, or whether or not you find a good reason not to and step back out again. Because I'll tell you, that's what we're looking at. That's what happens in our society. That's how we went from citizen to consumer. Was suddenly what we found was that we could be specialized and we could step back and therefore didn't have the responsibility to do this, to participate in this, to play with this, to run for public office, to participate in the various areas that we can do. Being a citizen demands that we actually apply ourselves. Being a consumer means that we spend and we have that outer flow only, not that inner take back in again. And I'll share with you is that this is going to transform the world because we're awakening to it. You can see it in the activities and the action of the world around you. People are becoming more applying their principles to the world around them and standing forward for who they were born to be. Understanding and appreciating that we're all part of one mosaic that makes up one large, beautiful picture that demonstrates and shares a little bit from each and every one of us. What I want to ask you to do is I want to ask you whether or not you think that this is a place where you are permitted to be yourself. Instead of asking when was it that you stopped being yourself, perhaps I could ask you, when is it that you plan on start being yourself? When is it that you plan on stepping forward to become that authentic human being that you were born, that fit to be, that fits perfectly in the mosaic of this thing called life? Not just in this center. And I'll tell you, I'll supply you with a tool to be able to do it. The tool is this. It's called Seva, which is selfless service to God. And in this teaching, we can call it Seva, selfless service to life, if you choose. To be able to start stepping forward and living your life from that authentic, actualized person who you were born to be. To step forward and actually know that you have a value and a worth that goes beyond the concept that you think it does. And that your feeling and your thought of your whether or not you're worthwhile or whether or not you're valued in an area is secondary. It's not something that comes from the outside. It's something that comes from the inside. If you're sitting out there saying, you know, I can't make a difference, I'm telling you, you're wrong. You already make a difference. And that as you show up and apply yourself to the world around you, that difference becomes palpable. It becomes something which is concrete and in form. Each and every one of us are born to fit that place and fit that role and fit that situation, no matter what. This last week, I put out a news press release for Centers for Spiritual Living that supported the concept of equal marriage rights. We can no longer afford to cut ourselves out of society by thinking that we don't fit in because other people don't agree with us. We can no longer afford to cut other people out of society thinking that they don't fit and they don't belong. I'll tell you, you know, the steps that we take, every step we take about becoming authentic, it's a human right. That's what it is. And every time that you are restricted in being who you were born to be, I'm not talking about who you want to defend yourself as, but who you were born to be. Every time that you step into that, what you are doing is you are demonstrating your support of human rights. Because you were born perfect to live this life in perfection, in harmony with those who are around you. You were born with a purpose so much greater than what you can imagine. You are the light of the world itself. And that within you is that spark that is required in order to transform the world. I told you I was going to talk about spiritual community, and here's what I want to say. I want to say that we have a responsibility to show up. We have a responsibility to show up so that we can support others in becoming what we already become when we do show up. The activity and the action of participation is what is required from us in our life today. Back when I was a citizen, there was no second thought about that. I was doing my ruminations and reflections on the fire of 2003 that went through the Okanagan. And when I was a young man, when I was 14 years old, as a matter of fact, I lied about my age and signed up and became a firefighter. And those were the days where when a fire broke out in the Okanagan, the police would go down to the bars and they'd empty out the bars. Do you remember that? Am I the only one who's that old? But they, literally, it was a law that if you were caught on the street and you were needed to help do something, that you were automatically enrolled or drafted to do it. So at 14, I signed up to become a forest firefighter, and I thought I was pretty good at it, and I traveled around British Columbia fighting fires. When the 2003 fire happened, I can remember looking at it burn through my town, which is my hometown. And I remember watching it rage through. And I remember that sense and that feeling of powerlessness that existed. And I can remember trying to get on so that I could go help fight the fires and them saying, oh no, 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 no. We only have professional firefighters now to do that. And I remember my feeling of the separation and the difference. And think about this for a second. They were telling me I couldn't go into danger, thank you. They were telling me they didn't need my 12 hours a day, 7 day a week work. And why isn't that a good thing? And the reason it isn't a good thing is because it takes away my fulfillment and my right to help protect and demonstrate, reflect and share with my community. That's why. And it helps build that separation and that difference and that gulf that is created that separates us from the truth of who we are to what we serve in the outside world in the form of capitalism. Now, this might sound like it's been a little foggy, this whole talk, but I will share this with you. I'll share that this is a home and this is a place where you are invited to participate. Not only invited, but you are encouraged to do it. You are encouraged to step up and let your opinion be known. And you're encouraged, which demonstrates in our leadership meeting next week, which encourages you to become yourself and become authentic when you do it. And you know what would happen if we all did that? Not just here in the community, but if we did that throughout the world, what would happen is we would create a world that worked for everyone. That simple. And all we need to do is be authentic for ourselves and not be frightened when other people are authentic for them. If I have one desire for the world today, it's to create a world that works for everyone. And the answer is so simple. Be yourself and let other people be themselves. And with that, what we'll do is we'll live in that harmony and that Eden and that heaven. I bless you and I thank you. Bye-bye.